From factories to farms, to small towns and large cities, every part of American life was transformed during World War II. Olathe, Kansas was no exception. This agricultural community would play a small but important role in the war, and soon a small invasion began in Olathe. In 1942, United States Navy personnel began to pour into the small Kansas town, and the skies over Olathe would never be the same. A small auxiliary Naval Reserve Aviation Base had been operating out of Kansas City's Fairfax Airport since 1935. But with the start of the war, and a new North American aircraft factory now on the site, the Navy couldn't expand the base to meet the needs of training thousands of new pilots for World War II. The U.S. military's top brass decided that Commander D.W. Tomlinson's Navy Reserve Unit would be moved to a new facility somewhere in the Kansas City metropolitan area. In January 1942, the United States Navy found their answer and purchased 640 acres, roughly 25 miles southwest of Kansas City, near Gardner, Kansas. Construction of the Naval Air Station began immediately, including three 5,000-foot runways, hangars, barracks, and administration buildings. However, many buildings remained unfinished when the first cadet class arrived in July 1942. 14 auxiliary fields in the surrounding area were also built to provide extra training opportunities and for emergency landings. One of those fields is the site of the present-day Johnson County Executive Airport in Olathe. On October 1, 1942, a small commissioning ceremony was held to officially open the base, even though the pilot factory had been training cadets for 3 months. One of the first cadets to receive primary training would go on to great fame.
The base was brand new. We were the first people in one of the barracks there. And whenever it rained, there were big puddles. There were no sidewalks yet on most of the base. And so we were slogging around through the mud part of the time. And they built wooden sidewalks out there, duck boards, that we walked on to get across the mud to get into the barracks. And then we flew the old primary trainers, the yellow Perils they were called, the two-wing yellow primary trainers, open cockpit airplanes. And they checked us out in those and was there for, I think, about 3 months. And then I was transferred on to Corpus Christi, Texas for advanced training.
The training that Glenn and his peers received at Olathe was the first phase of educating new pilots, called primary flight training. More than 4,500 pilots logged 463,220 training hours in 2 years, with only 25 fatal accidents. After completing their primary training in Olathe, cadets were shipped out to other bases for advanced training. One of the lieutenants stationed at ONAS knew Walt Disney from the animator's childhood and early adult life in Kansas City and asked him to draw a logo for the Naval Air Station. Disney's team created the Flying Jayhawk in October 1942, though in more politically correct times, the station was to have two subsequent logos. The Flying Jayhawk is the most memorable. The base operated as a small city. Navy trainees took their sweethearts to big band dances at the base's hangars. The drill hall and athletic building was named after Ensign Niall Kinnick, who was killed in active duty. Cadets swam in Kinnick Hall's Olympic-sized pool, the only such facility west of the Mississippi. The 37,000-foot building had 5 full-size basketball courts and was used for athletic and ceremonial activities. The base also had its own sports teams, newsletter aptly named the Flying Jayhawk, and even a bowling alley. Other on-base facilities included a state-of-the-art medical center, which had a surgical suite, dental units, X-ray room, and 126 patient beds. On July 30, 1942, FDR had signed legislation authorizing the commissioning of women in the U.S. Naval Reserve. Known as the WAVES, Women Accepted for Voluntary Emergency Service, these women trained for non-combat roles at air stations across the country, including the Olathe base. The first female trainees arrived in Olathe in July 1943. Once in Johnson County, this particular group trained to become transport specialists and went on to serve in the war effort. At the peak of the WAVES program, 228 female trainees were based in Olathe, around a tenth of the number of men. The U.S. Navy had plenty of seasoned pilots by 1943. Mother Nature would also help convince the Navy to make a pivotal change in the life of ONAS. On May 9, 1943, a tornado came through the airfield and destroyed 134 N2Ss. Glenn Wallace recalled the scene. "The next morning, the field was littered with crumpled up airplanes, a big pile over in one corner." Instead of replacing the ruined aircraft, the Navy chose to change the mission of ONAS the following year. On September 10, 1944, ONAS switched its focus to educating transport pilots and support staff for the Naval Air Transport Services Squadron 3. Domestically, this unit's main responsibility was flying wounded veterans between various military hospitals across the nation using twin-engined R-4D and four-engine R-5D planes, including some purchased from Transworld Airlines. Olathe residents soon became used to the rumble of these sleek giants, passing overhead as they flew in and out of the NATS's Continental Headquarters. Several thousand feet above Olathe residents, wounded veterans winged their way to treatment and rehabilitation facilities, but first had to endure cold at altitude as the R-4D and R-5Ds lacked heating and cooling technology in their cabins. With the end of World War II in 1945 and the start of the early Cold War period, U.S. military commanders changed the mission of the Olathe Naval Air Station again. From early 1946 onward, it was to train naval reservists as well as ground approach operators and air traffic controllers who needed to be ready for duty when they were called up. Soon, the distinctive K designation on the blue tails of Olathe aircraft being flown by Naval Reserve units would become synonymous with what would be called the Prairie Navy. Reserve aircraft flown out of Olathe included fighters like the F-6F Hellcat, the famous gull-winged F-4U Corsair, and the F-8F Bearcat. Also flown were larger aircraft like the massive PB-4Y2 Privateer and the P-2V Neptune, a maritime patrol and anti-submarine warfare aircraft. With America embroiled in the Korean War during the summer of 1950, members of VF-884 U.S. Navy Reserve Squadron were called to active duty at Olathe. After undergoing rigorous training, the so-called Bitter Birds were flown to Korea in March 1951, where they launched their F-4U-4 Corsairs from the aircraft carrier USS Boxer, becoming one of the first reserve units to strike communist forces in North Korea. During this first tour, the Bitter Birds served until October 24, 1951, and then returned to Korea for a second tour that lasted from August 11, 1952 until March 17, 1953. They flew 1,519 missions, dropped 750,000 pounds of bombs, and fired 1,400,000 rounds of ammunition. 12 pilots from the Bitter Bird Squadron lost their lives. In 1950, the Navy personnel at ONAS welcomed two divisions from the U.S. Air Force, the Air Force Reserve Training Command, and the 130th Air Control and Warning Squadron. The next year, the Navy lengthened the runways to make them suitable for the higher speed jets that were replacing propeller aircraft. The first jets to arrive in Olathe were FJ-1 Furies. And later, other jet aircraft included the F-9F Cougar and the F-4D Skyray. From July 1950 to July 1952, ONAS was under the command of World War II combat veteran James Flatley. During the war, Flatley played a pivotal role in the Battle of the Coral Sea and helped develop early fighter tactics against the Japanese. As commander of Olathe, Flatley was responsible for acquiring the longer runways needed for jet training. For the multi-million dollar purchase of adjacent land that was used to expand overfilled housing facilities, add more recreational space, and provide new hangars for the increased number of planes that would train pilots for service in the Korean War. Such was Flatley's impact on ONAS and the local community that the main aviation field and several of the base's streets were later named after him. On April 4, 1955, the Jet Transitional Training Unit came to Olathe. The JTTU helped so-called desk pilots acquire the necessary skills to fly combat aircraft and to transition pilots from propeller-driven aircraft to jets. Often, the transition was not an easy one. John Glenn renewed his connection with Olathe in 1957 during a record attempt.
I was involved with setting the first supersonic transcontinental flight from Los Angeles to New York. And the first leg of that flight went to Albuquerque and did an in-flight refueling flying by Albuquerque. And the second leg went by, and the tanker that refueled me was based at Olathe and took off, and then I went by that area and I got a new load of fuel, and on to the third tanker point was over Indianapolis and then on into Floyd Bennett Field in New York. So while I wasn't on the base there at Olathe, I appreciated the support they gave in the tanker that let me refuel over Olathe going by.
In 1959, the Army began using ONAS as one of the bases in its Nike Hercules missile program as part of the activities of the 5th Missile Battalion, 55th Artillery. With Olathe having proved its worth to military leaders in Washington, ONAS continued to be used at full capacity throughout the 1960s. Starting in 1965, Navy flyers who required training in fleet attack came to Olathe, where they flew A-4 Skyhawks. Then in May 1967 came the Marine Reconnaissance Squadron 4, the only reserve unit in the Marine Corps that trained in aerial photographic reconnaissance. Though the Marine cadets gained valuable experience while at ONAS, it would not be enough to save the station. After the record military spending of the Vietnam War era, the U.S. military budget was slashed by several billion dollars. Bases across the country were shutting for good, and unfortunately, Olathe was on this list. It had prepared thousands of pilots for combat in World War II, launched hundreds of flights to take wounded veterans for treatment across the country, and prepared hundreds of flyers and their support crews for service in conflict and in peacetime. Now a proud 30-year chapter in Olathe's history was closed. During an emotional ceremony in July of 1970, the Stars and Stripes came down the flagpole for the last time. In 1973, the Johnson County Airport Commission acquired the land, and while it operated civilian aircraft at the newly named Johnson County Industrial Airport, the Naval Air Reserve continued training pilots on aircraft such as the Grumman S-2A Tracker. In 1994, the Johnson County Industrial Airport changed its name to the New Century Air Center. Despite Olathe's newfound focus, it retains a strong connection with the U.S. military. the Army's F-158th Aviation Battalion's twin-rotor CH-47 Chinooks provide helicopter transport for troops and material between local bases, such as Fort Hood and Fort Carson. 82 men and 9 women from the 158th did a one-year tour in Afghanistan between 2011 and 2012. Olathe resident Spencer Duncan, an Army Reserve door gunner, was killed in action during Operation Enduring Freedom on August 6, 2011, when the CH-47 Chinook he was flying in was brought down by an enemy rocket. 10 days later, thousands of Olathe residents lined the city streets as a parade drove slowly by, honoring the life and memory of the 21-year-old who gave his life for his country. From the days of canvas and wood propeller planes, to the jet age, to the supersonic aircraft and GPS-guided helicopters of today, ONAS equipped pilots and their support crews to protect American freedom. The men and women of the Olathe Naval Air Station proved their worth from the European and Pacific theaters of World War II to Korea, to Iraq and Afghanistan, and beyond. And while it may rarely be mentioned in the same breath as other illustrious military installations, there is no doubt that the Olathe Naval Air Station and the 4 branches of the U.S. military once stationed here made a significant contribution to the cause of preserving freedom and liberty at home and abroad.